All right. Hello, everybody. This is James Stanley. I hope you're having a fantastic day today and a great start to the week. Tomorrow is when the calendar thickens up a bit. We get the Bank of Canada rate decision, and then on Thursday, we get the European Central Bank, and then Friday, non-farm payrolls, and that leads into next week's FOMC. So there's a lot to work with over the next week and a half. But there's a number of setups I wanted to look at today. I want to parse through those in consideration of that data that's on the horizon. Before I do so, I need to show you a risk disclaimer. I'm going to leave this up for 60 seconds. I ask that you read it. I'll be on the other side, then we'll start chopping up some charts. As usual, this webinar is about you, ladies and gentlemen. So if there's any setups you have or pairs you want to take a look at, send those my way. If I'm not covering them, I'll do my best to answer when we get to the Q&A portion of today's webinar. So I'm going to show that disclaimer. Please read it. I'll be on the other side, approximately 60 seconds. Thank you, folks. All right, that is more than 60 seconds on my watch. Let's get this started. So first and foremost, like I said at the beginning, there's a Bank of Canada rate decision tomorrow, ECB on Thursday, NFP on Friday, and then the Fed is next week. So a pretty loaded schedule that we have going into the end of next week. Now, what we looked at last week still very much remains in the conversation. When we looked at the dollar last week, it was trying to hold this bounce right in there. And it was that same resistance zone, 105 to 105.13, that came in to snag the high again. Now, that happened on Wednesday, really strong day, but notice we finished right at that FIBO level, 105.13. Bulls tried to run a break on Thursday, couldn't get very far. Sellers just ended up setting on that thing. And then Friday, we got the PCE report that came in right at 2.8%. And so to me, that's kind of a Rorschach diagram. It becomes whatever you want to make it, right? Three consecutive months at 2.8%. It illustrates a stall with inflation, the same progress we had seen in core PCE late last year, earlier this year. It's not continuing. But nonetheless, there's also not that re-energizing of inflation that's got folks very freaked out. As a case in point, I think we can go over to the 10-year and look at the way that's performed around this batch of data. And so when we looked at this last week, the 10-year was heavy into this run where yields were running higher, higher, higher. We got all the way up past that 4.6% mark. That was on Wednesday. But you can see on Thursday, going along with that USD move of weakness, we started to see yields settle a bit. Continued on Friday through the PCE report, so far through Monday, which seems as though it could have been profit-taking from folks that rode that wave. But if we take a step back, we'll see the 10-year is at a critical spot right now. That 4.35% marker is something I've been talking about for a little while now. But this was the yield high back in Q4 of 22, right? If you remember, that's when stocks started to put in that massive turn. Like if we go over to ES, you see, it was like Q4 22, right around that like middle to late portion of October. Like if the weekly, it was that October 10th bar that set the low here in ES, right? And it was just a couple weeks later that we saw that shift in yields. Right there, right? Topped October 17th, the week of October 17th. So 1 week after ES had bottomed. Now, we saw that 4.35 come back into the play a little under a year later, right? It was right here, August 23, and eventually bulls were able to ramp above that. And then the next marker that really caught a lot of attention was that 5% handle. Now, 5% only traded for, if I remember correctly, a single day in tens. Yeah, you could see right here, just off 10-year yields, held below five, tested above five, and then got slammed. And then a lower high, and then yield pullback was on the way, right? And that's very much remained a push point. And as we were getting this pullback in yields through the end of last year, that's when the dollar was really getting smashed. So, I mean, we could even chart this up. And, you know, it was like around the November 1st rate decision when the Fed starts getting a bit more dovish. Like right in there. There we go. That was the Fed rate decision on November 1, right? And that precipitous slide, that helped to launch stocks into the end of the year, but also helped to slam the dollar. That was November 1st. You know, even in the morning of that rate decision, it looked like the dollar could still break out. You know, and again, this is pretty similar to what happened in May, which we'll get to in a moment. But November 1st rate decision, prices peeled back thereafter. It was the NFP print right here a couple days after that FOMC rate decision that really started to slam things. And the reason is that was, we saw the headline number miss, gave a bit of consternation around U.S. economic growth that we're seeing NFP now come in below expectation just after the Fed held a pretty dovish overall outlay. So it's a lower low. We bounce up to a lower high. And then it was CPI in November that really started to get that trend going. Right, now, I point this out because I think this has pertinence across markets. I mean, again, we could see this in tens playing out pretty well. So November 1, that's the rate decision. November 3, that's the NFP report. Notice that the 10 spikes down or 10 yields spike down. The bounce from that finds a lower high. November 14th, that was a CPI report. It gets slammed again, fresh low, and the slide continues all the way into a low right around December 27, December 28th, right? So, I mean, we can even chart this up against USD and notice a lot of similarities between those two themes. CPI, bottoms right on the 28th, starts to climb back into the new year. And, you know, I said this quite a bit in Q1, but it almost seemed as though the natural force of the trend was higher, but we still had that dovish Fed quality to consider. And at multiple opportunities, the Fed stepped on this by retaining a pretty dovish look. Like that was the Austin Goolsbee comment mid-February, right after the CPI report. Let's not get all flipped out about one CPI report. Since the dollar a tailspin pullback all the way until the March NFP report hits, right? But you can see a couple of important inflections here off the NFP, a couple of important moves, like that NFP-driven move, that NFP-driven move that helped to set a low in USD. Now, the dollar climbed back. It re-engaged that same 105 level. The pullback from that is what I'm looking at right now. That was at 103.92. Now, we looked at this in late April, and we looked at it in late April. It looked like a pretty clean range. We already had one resistance inflection around that 105 handle. It led to a pretty massive pullback. We had a second. And again, this was as the Fed was sounding really pretty dovish. But the pullback from that caught a higher low. And that higher low that I'm tracking is 103.92. It's off of that swing that was tested twice, setting a short-term double bottom formation. Now, the breakout from that was another one of these CPI-fueled moves. The CPI report hit April 10th. See a strong bullish move in USD. It finally gets above that 105 handle and continues to run all the way until it gets to 106.50, which was simply the gap from that November FOMC rate decision right in there. And it's like the bottom portion of that gap. We closed FOMC day, like we finished that day, daily candle closed 106.88. Thursday it opens 106.50, and then it's a pretty much a dead drop down. We just started to tickle that zone right here in the aftermath of the CPI print in April. The pullback from that held pretty strong. We went back up for another test, but that was the May FOMC rate decision, which very similar to November, saw the Fed sound fairly dovish considering the data that was out there. Now, the minutes from that came off a little bit differently, but nonetheless, FOMC helps to hold the high. 2 days later, an NFP report jolts a fresh low. The pullback from that finds a lower high. Runs down to a lower low. This was a very messy set of a lower high, but it's down now testing for a lower low. Now it's technically set a fresh monthly low, but you'll notice that sellers didn't get very far. And if we go down shorter term, it looks like bulls are trying to come back to force a pullback. Like if I go down to this 2 hour chart, you can see where we tickled inside of that 103.92 to 104.08 zone. And so far it's brought a short term pullback, short term higher highs. It looks a little bit cleaner on the hourly. There we go. Now the test is whether or not this can hold a higher low to work a deeper pullback type of scenario. A couple of levels of note that I'm tracking, 104.52 still remains relevant. But really, it's that 105, 105.13 area that still continues to stick out. 200-day also of consideration in here. You know, like if you're a USD bear right now, a pullback to and a hold of resistance at the 200 to that 104.52 level, that could be pretty attractive. The more interesting scenario is if that shows but doesn't play out, right? If we see that resistance hold temporarily, but the pullback from that merely finds another higher low, then that shows that we're seeing a longer-term grind or build of support right in this zone, 103.92, 104.08, thereabouts. On the underside of price, there's a couple of different levels that I think are interesting. Below 103.92, 103.50 has some historical relevance. 103.21 is a Fibonacci level that had a pretty clean hit back here in March. Then around 102.87 that I'm tracking for a point of Fibonacci point of interest, but it's also prior resistance, turn support. This is a bit messy, but I'm still keeping it on the chart in case we get a breakdown type of move in there. I'm skeptical on prolonged bearish runs in USD. And one of the reasons for that is the euro. So we have the ECB on Thursday. Widely expected they're going to kick off their rate cutting round. But the ECB had what I consider to be a really sharp move a year ago. They stopped issuing forward guidance on rates, which I think is something that has really snarled the Fed in their rate hike attempt to whittle down inflation. And I think you can see this in the housing market, right? A lot of folks that are just saying, well, you know, I don't want to buy a new house at 7% or 8%, so I'm just going to sit in my house with my 3% mortgage and I'll wait for rates to come down. Because the Fed's telling me they're going to come down next year, the year after. I'll just wait. And now, if we had the full impact of higher rates, then I don't think investors would be anticipating lower rates coming around the pike, and instead would say, well, you know what, I better get them now before rates go up to 10% or 11% or 12%. You know, I think that would be a much different impact across the economy if that forward guidance wasn't there. But the ECB got rid of that forward guidance. And as a case in point, even though euro economic data has remained less strong than that of the US, even though the ECB is lining up for a rate cut on Thursday, and we still don't know when the Fed's going to be able to cut, the euro dollar has been in a strong bullish move ever since that range support came into play in mid-April. I want to take a step back. I want to do a tops-down look here, starting from the weekly. So we've got to call it what it is. For the past 17 months, euro dollar has been range-bound. And much of that range has existed between 105 and 110. Resistance a little messier. You'll notice the Fibonacci level up here at 110.71. There's been a couple of inflections there. The peak that came in was 112.75, which quite simply is a 618 retracement of this major move, the 21 to 22 sell-off. That held the high last summer, the reversal of which caught support at 105. And since then, it's just been driving into a tighter and tighter and tighter range. But that 106.11 is what came into play in mid-April, helping to hold the lows. There's more context for that range support to run all the way down to around that 105 level that was last in play back here in October. Go down a bit tighter though, and to my eyes, bulls still have control of the matter. And the way this played out was really interesting. So mid-April, again, go back to that CPI report right here, CPI in on April 10th, drives a strong move of dollar strength, euro weakness. That's eventually what got us the 106.11 test a week later, less than a week later. And you can see where it was almost trepidatious, but even just off the coloring of these candles, you can see where bulls are coming in more actively, more actively, more actively. They're not really able to control a strong move because this is just a bounce off of lows. But that starts to shift later in April. I think the big takeaway here was May 1st, the FOMC rate decision. Again, Fed sounded pretty dovish. All in all, given the backdrop of data that we had on both inflation and employment. NFP report right here is what started to get bulls more motivation. They run up, test above the 200-day moving average, although they couldn't hold it for long. The pullback from that, though, remained pretty clean. Held support right around prior resistance, 107 and a quarter. And then it was the May CPI release, or the CPI release in May, that eventually got us the 200 DMA breakout and the push up here, right into that level. It held just inside of 109, but a really strong breakout on the back of that CPI report. And since then, it's been largely just calling back of that prior bullish breakout. Now, support held above the 200 DMA last week. This was something we talked about on the Tuesday webinar. And on Tuesday, it's right when they were setting this gravestone doji, right off that 108.70, 108.77 level. I'm going to bring that back up because that's relevant for today, right here. A gravestone doji, strong pullback move on Wednesday, but support holds above the 200 DMA. Now, yesterday was in my opinion, a show from bulls, because, you know, when we closed last week, we had a resistance hold here. When we opened up this week, we still had that same type of resistance hold theme sticking around, right? You can see how the Sunday open, sellers take a shot, but they get caught right here at 108.35 in the morning. Strong bullish breakout. But if you look at this on a daily chart, that looks like a hammer. See that wide underside wick, strong upper body? Those hammer formations are generally approached with the aim of bullish reversals, as they're often found near lows. Or it could just be an intraday run from bulls taking advantage of a pullback type of scenario after support level comes into play. Flings it up to a fresh monthly high, almost a two-month high, but not quite. And the pullback from that is so far held right around that 108.70, 108.77 spot of prior resistance. And it's been pretty well worn so far this year. Now, where this comes into roost, again, if we draw back to that weekly, let me go to the other one, it's a little cleaner. We draw back to that weekly. I'm tracking the start of range resistance at 109.43. 109.43 is the 50 fib of the same major move that helped to mark the lows in April. Quite simply, 50% of the 21 to 22 sell-off. It lands right at 109.43. Better than that, though, better than just a theoretical idea that it might come in as resistance, we could see where this did so in March, and it cut those highs really very well. Notice first week of March, price tries to break out, and remember, it was the NFP report that we got on March 8th, so the end of that weekly bar is when the NFP report came out pretty hot, helping to set a low in the dollar. The week after that, we see continuation. Now, the following week, the third week, you could even see where bulls went for one last test up that 109.43 level and failed. Right. So when I see that, that's in my mind recognition of a resistance level. As you can see it playing out with lower highs over three consecutive weeks. And eventually sellers were able to take control until we go down to the 106.11 level. So if we could see this bounce continue, that's where I think it starts to get more interesting for swing potential. Right around that 109.43 area. A little bit higher, there's a couple of additional spots like the 110 handle. Came in to hold the highs twice in the first couple weeks of the year, hasn't been back in place since. So even if bulls can get a break above 109.43, I'm skeptical they'd be able to run it significantly above 110, especially if they do it near term. You know, because you could see the reaction that we had on yesterday's candle. That's, you know, almost seems like a pure intraday fade to me, where euro was dipping, buyers came in with a very big statement, ran it back up, set a fresh monthly high. And the high and the pullback from that so far has been met with bullish support. So I just have to go with the trend and anticipating that this could eventually retest that 109.43 level until we start to see a breach of some of this bullish structure. It's not showing yet. It's not showing now. But it's one of those rate cut rally themes that's going on. And I think the big basis on that is U.S. economic data, which brings us to the NFP report on Friday. So again, I'm still looking at this near term as bulls being in control, holding a higher low around prior resistance, that 108.70, 108.77 zone. Skeptical of significant drive beyond 110 and maybe even 109.43. So if we do see buyers push that trend over the next couple of days, this becomes a spot of interest for swing potential. But if that NFP report on Friday comes out hot, I think we could see dollar strength come back in very short order. And again, the reason for that, dials right back to the chart and what we've had so far this year, right? Where the Fed has remained dovish for most of this period, yet there's still an argument to be made for a continuation of higher highs and higher lows. You know, especially given that we've had a hold above that 103.92 level on this pullback that's now lasted for more than a month. If buyers can hold that spot in the, that line in the sand, and if NFP comes out hot on Friday, you know, there's more divergence between European economic data and U.S. economic data, and that's excuse for bulls to push the envelope a bit. And I think there's consequence of that. I think there's other areas that could get a little bit more gnarly. Like, for instance, we've been talking about stocks here for a while now. And you look at NQ, so NASDAQ futes are looking pretty shaky at this point. So again, it was the Friday PCE report that initially helped to bring a bit of strength to euro, a bit of weakness to USD. Interestingly, you look at the way that NQ priced that in. So that report dropped at 8:30 on Friday. The initial reaction was one of strength that was then met with a hard fade. This thing dropped like 400 points over the next few hours. Now, it eventually found support right at a major spot, 18,250. And that was at the 12 o'clock bar, the 12:30 bar prints inside. And then the last few hours of the session showed a massive rally that saw most of that loss clawed back, the net of which provided this. That body might be a little too wide to call a doji, but it's a long-legged spinning top at its worst. Now, that enthusiasm had some continuation yesterday, but kind of the same ordeal where when we get up to this 18,691 level, bulls all of a sudden have been getting shy. If that NFP report comes out really hot on Friday, then I think this thing could see a fairly deep pullback. And I don't think that's a novel idea either, because one of the things that's really been pumping this up has been the Fed. The idea that the Fed is closer to a rate cut and probably won't have to hike. As a case in point, you can see the pullback theme in Q2 that hit really quick. That was FOMC day. Now, the initial move on FOMC day was a rally, but much of that was just given back. It was the NFP report a couple days later that really got bulls back in the driver's seat. And that early May NFP report was a big one because it was the first one that missed the headline number, it missed the headline expectation since November of last year. And you guys remember what happened on the November? Right there. Oh, no, it was right there. Excuse me. Friday, November 3rd. So from here to here, every NFP report that was released beat the headline number. But these both were especially important because that's when the index was trying to dig itself out of a hole, trying to breach above some lower high resistance as bulls were getting back in control and taking charge. So NFP could be vitally important here. This got another run of life on the CPI print on the 15th, right there. You could see that's when we had the breakout and the push up to a fresh ATH and NQ. Continuation of which ran all the way up to a 19K test that just couldn't take out yet. Now you look at this on the 4 hour, and there's a case to be made for sellers starting to take a more and more aggressive hand here. We had the fresh lower low last Friday after that PCE report, pops up, lower high resistance, gets defended. A hold of support so far right at that 18,545 level, but if sellers could defend that 18,691 and produce yet another lower high, this thing could end up looking right for a pullback. Which, interestingly, counters a bit with ES. ES is looking a little bit more bullish to me right now than NQ is, which was the opposite of what we had last week. Now, there are still a couple of zones that remain in play, and we've seen some really strong responses from buyers, but a similar type of deal where, you know, last Friday, initially we had bearish continuation, right? All the way until this 52.13 level came into play. Bulls jumped in at that point. And kind of like we looked at in NQ, it was a really massive late session rally. But notice where the low, that one, it's just below that 52.13 level, But notice where the low in yesterday's pullback came in, right off of 52.47. And that's not a novel level. I'll show you how I got it. I just pulled it from that swing high right there, 52.47. But it caught the exact low. And notice that's almost a perfect doji yesterday. All right, get down a little bit tighter though. There we go. Let's go to hourly. Down a little bit tighter though. And while there has been a hold of lower high resistance, there's also been this pretty strong response to support on these dips, you know, especially after yesterday's massive run back up to 53. So right now, ES looks a little stronger to me than NQ, which it kind of goes back to what I was saying about the Q2 open, right? If we look at the Q2 open, the way this traded, that was March 8th on the back of the NFP print. We held a fresh ATH, or I don't think we'd ATH at that point, but we held a fresh high at that point. A couple weeks later, March 21, another fresh high, and then April 1st, first day of Q2 trade, fresh ATH. Now you look at the way that played in NQ, it was very different. The March 8th high was matched on March 21. That sets up the double top formation. April 1, as ES is making a fresh ATH, lower high here in NQ. The fact that NQ was holding back a bit or wasn't as strong as ES highlighted the fact that there was pullback potential in here, which is eventually what played out with some help from that April 10th CPI report. Now, when I looked at this last week, it was the opposite. NQ seemed to be leading the way higher, and ES appeared to be lagging behind, which to my mind said there was an open door for fresh ATHs. That hasn't happened yet. Not only that, it's starting to shift again. So if I'm looking on the bearish side of stocks, NQ might be more attractive than ES at the moment. If I'm looking on the long side of stocks, ES, in my opinion, has a more attractive case for strength than we have in NQ, and it's largely on the basis of the support being really well defended so far. Now, NES, the levels to watch for, that 53.50 level was a hard line in the sand. Notice the bulls took multiple trips, were not able to hold above it. 53.34, also of interest. It's a long-term Fibo retracement, or a Fibo extension, excuse me. It's pretty muddy between 53 and 53.34 in my mind. So we're holding right at that resistance right now. But if today's candle can close halfway below the body of Friday's body, which I could just use a Fibo retracement tool, then we may have an evening star formation to work with. Evening stars often approach with the aim of a short-term top or a high. And in this case, it could be a lower high. 50% mark from Friday's candle body, I have it 52.75. So if today's daily closes below 52.75, I can work off of an evening star formation that would show a possible lower high right off that 53 test. So a couple of interesting things going on in stocks right now. But again, if I'm looking bearish equities, again, NQ might have a better case on that simply because we've seen sellers stretch a bit more on that move. And there's a couple of relevant levels that remain in play here. 18.691 is what I'm tracking as near-term key resistance. 18.626 is in play today, but that's been really well weathered. 18.545 of interest. But for sellers to get that fresh lower low, they got to stretch below 18.250. So big spot. Big spot. But with the calendar like we have over the next couple of days, going into next week, that is absolutely possible. All right, let's get back over to the FX front. So again, DXY. Got this at a pretty major spot of support. But as usual, I want to try to work with something that plays each way. And I'm largely looking at very similar setups here, where if I'm looking for dollar weakness, if I'm looking for the bottom to give out of the support, I'm pretty much still focusing on Aussie and cable. If I'm looking for that support to hold, if we are looking at a bounce, I still like dollar CAD. Dollar Swiss, however, I'm gonna have to take off the radar because it's breaking 90 support right now. And I'm gonna parse through all of those right now as we speak. So again, for bearish USD scenarios, this thing's gonna fall out of bed, break that support, run down to 103.57. I think this is one of the more attractive major markets at the moment because it doesn't have to deal with that 109.43 resistance, 110 resistance that we have in euro dollar that's been really well worn over the past 17 months as that range has been building. Cable, however, offers a couple of interesting things. One being the fundamental overlay. Core CPI in the UK is higher than core CPI in the US, pure and simple. So thereby, from an inflation perspective, the BOE may have even less ability to cut rates right now than the Fed. More than that is price action in the pair, the way this thing has responded. And I've been talking about this for a little while now. Let's go back to that one. Like if we draw back to the May Bank of England rate decision, which was right here, initially the pair was dipping until it found support right in that zone, like 2450 to 2466. And it's another one of those hammer formations, very similar to what I showed you on Eurodollar daily yesterday, right? These hammers, I think, could be a big item because intraday, bears are taking it one way, trying to test a fresh low. Bulls not only overpower them, but they take control and end the day with a green daily bar. And then that hammer continues. There's another hammer lookalike right there. Long underside wick, strong candlestick body, closed right near the top. And it continued. That was CPI day in May. US CPI comes out at a fresh three-year low, or core CPI comes out at a fresh three-year low. Cable just runs up to that next resistance zone. Now that resistance zone, 2692 to 2710, then got repurposed and tested multiple times as support. I think it was like 2.5 weeks of support tests. Bears just could not get a daily close below it. Even was tested yesterday. But again, very strong response as this just pushes right up to a fresh 2 month high. Now this morning, again, we saw another pullback, but we saw support hold at that 2750 level. So there's still bullish indications here off of the chart. Longer term, the level that I think could be a bit trickier is right there, just inside of that 129 handle. There's a couple different things going on from that. So this is the long-term major move that I'm tracking, taking the 2007 top down to the 2022 bottom. The 23.6 mark of that comes in at 128, I think it's 98. Might be off by a couple pips, but 128.98. And then lo and behold, you look at what price came in to catch the high. And March of this year is right off that 23.6 FIBO. But to a strong pullback until we found support off that bullish trend line. Now we get back to the daily. That's the spot that I think is going to be pretty contentious if we could get back into the picture. But this is still one of my favorite short side USD plays at the moment. Aussie dollar. And I shared with you guys, I think it was 2 weeks ago, and then again last week, why I thought this was one of the more attractive short USD scenarios. My look here really goes longer term. Let me see if I got a prettier chart over here. That's that one. My look here goes a little longer term. 63 is a tough spot for Aussie. Now, granted, we're 66 and a half right now. A 350 pip stop is not really something I'm interested in. But if others are imagining that there could be turbulence below 63, thereby leading them to slow their selling approach, maybe even look at buying off of 63, that's something that could impact price action. Now, there was, from my memory, one monthly close below 63. That was the COVID pandemic. Quickly picked back up. Tested below right here, October of 22. That was right around the time the stocks were bottoming. Tested again, October of 23, higher low, and just barely tickled that 63 level. Now, it's been very choppy, and I think I even showed this a couple weeks ago whenever I was getting it set up, but it's been very choppy, and from the daily, there's not been much for trend until recently. And as we've had this recent push of dollar weakness, Aussie has started to clean itself up a bit, fairly clean run of higher highs and higher lows and higher highs and higher lows. Now, at 66.04, I have a long-term Fibonacci level, and simply this is just a 23.6 from this major move, taking the high in 21 down to the low in 22. 23.6 of that's right at 66.04. That is what came into play to hold the lows on two different instances in late May and then the second to last day of May. So far, it's been defended by bulls. Go down a little bit tighter. There we go. And we got a run to a fresh high, a pullback. And right now you can see where there's an attempt to hold a higher low. That candle closes in an hour and a half. But if it closes like this, that could possibly be attractive for swings, especially if it's indecisive with a slightly higher low above an extended underside wick from the prior 4 hour bar. But this is still one of the more attractive short USD setups. And the reason for that is I think if we are going to see bearish USD, then I think that's going to come along with the overall hope of global growth on the back of rate cuts from the Fed, central bank supporting the global economy, et cetera. And if that scenario plays through, then I think that could be a positive for China. And if that's a positive for China, that could be a positive for Australia simply through the Australian-China proxy. That's my take on that one. But another one of my preferred pairs for USD weakness scenarios. USD strength, that's the tougher one right now because the dollar has been getting taken out to the woodshed since the May 1st rate decision. So a little more difficult to posit reversals because we're going against the status quo. But with that said, and this was something I tweeted last night, the dollar got throttled yesterday. And that shows up in most majors. Like we looked at the hammer-like setup in Euro, the hammer-like setup in cable. You know, most of these major pairs showed that dollar weakness visibly. But if we go over here, Canadian dollar was actually weaker than US. I don't know. Which one was it? No, I take that back. I was charting that off of a 4 hour. So yeah, USD was a bit weaker than CAD last week or yesterday. And USD was getting hammered. If you look at where that low held, it held right at that 36.13 zone we've been talking about. And as USD strength came back just a bit today, we could see where this stretched. Now take a step back, and this has a pretty clean chart where we had prior resistance right at that 36 handle, now coming back into support. It's been support that's been tested a couple of times. The 36.13 level, I'm just pulling straight off these highs. Talked about that level a couple of weeks ago, right at 36.90. That still remains a point that bulls haven't been able to do much above yet. But if we end up with the dollar holding that support zone, 103.92 to 104.08, I think this could be one of the more attractive topside USD setups. And we're going into a Bank of Canada rate decision on tomorrow. I think they're more of a coin flip, although the last I saw is a 75% expectation that they do cut. But I think the ISM report that we saw yesterday morning actually improves the odds of getting a BOC rate cut. One of the factors that could be holding them back is the idea that they would diverge from US economic themes. As in, if US strength is really still there and the US dollar is really very strong, and the BOC starts cutting rates, I mean, we could see dollar CAD challenging that 38.50 to 39 resistance zone and, you know, maybe even getting up to a 140 spot. And once that starts happening, well, now Canada is inviting in more inflationary pressure on the back of currency weakness. It's probably a situation the BOC wants to avoid at this point. And a little bit tighter, a little bit tighter, and there's still a case. There's still a case for bulls on the basis of this hold the support of prior resistance. Now, with that said, they're going to need to eventually press at highs or near resistance at some point if they do want to take control of the trend and bring another retest of 38.50 to 39. But structurally, I think this is one of the more attractive long USD setups at the moment. The other one that I've been tracking, which I'm now going to pull off the radar, was dollar Swiss, and I'll show you why. Well, I think it's pretty clear as to why. So pulling off of the weekly, we had a pretty decent defense of this area between 90 and 90.26, which, you know, it had even held or had an open door for last week. I think when we looked at this last week, as already testing. Yeah, we already had a test off of that zone. But it's getting shredded through right now. And so the setup no longer has that case for higher low support right off of the 90 handle. Now maybe something shows up here or here, but given the speed with which this has come down, I have very little interest in fading that weakness. So to get back in the driver's seat on the long side, I would need to see an actual legitimate build of support, you know, kind of similar to what we had back here at 87.61 back in March. You know, if that starts to show up, then the possibility of topside swings comes back into play. And, you know, and likely would need some strength in NFP to begin showing that scenario, but it's not there right now. So I'm going to nix this until it cleans itself up and then maybe put it back on the radar at some point. But support didn't hold. Nothing to follow, nothing to track there in my mind. All right, dollar yen. So I've been saying for a little while now that I think dollar yen remains an amplified USD variant. There might be a shift in that too. And I'm going off of the fact that since the intervention week, so the BOJ intervened here, accusations they'd intervened here, although I don't believe that was ever confirmed. But since that low came in at 152, there were no back-to-back days of weakness in dollar yen. One day of weakness that held through another day, but buyers came in, formed another one of those hammer formations right in there, right? Long underside wick, strong body. I mean, that strong intraday reversal could show you something. And it continued for a couple weeks after. Day of weakness here. But that was a pullback that got buyers back into the fray on Friday. But so far this week, it's gotten hammered. It stalled just ahead of the 157.50 level. Yesterday, I had this at support, 156.04. Sellers continued to take it. And now we're back below the 155 level. There could be a shift taking place here. And if I had to guess, it would draw back to this chart. And growing expectations that we might actually see the dollar take out that support at 103.92, 104.08. You know, because again, the Fed's been dovish for most of this year. For most of this year, the Fed has retained a dovish sound to my ears. And that's even with strong US economic data. I started to say back here, if that economic data just starts to go their way a little bit, we could end up seeing a pretty forceful move. And I think that's what was showing here. Dovish Fed, NFP, and then the April 10th CPI report, or excuse me, the May 15th CPI report. You know, we're finally starting to get data that goes in the direction that the Fed was wanting. And so it's opening the door for bears to take their shot. I think one of the things that's held this back so far was, I mean, it's the largest constituent of DXY, the euro, is going into a expected rate cut this week. And if the ECB says, yeah, we're going to do another, or we're thinking we might do another in like July or September, if they say that, then there's wherewithal for more euro weakness. I think that's what's holding this back. But if Lagarde can hold the line well on Thursday and say, well, we cut rates, now we want to take in the data before we make any other decisions, we're going to take a step back and see how this rate cut gets absorbed. If she takes that tact, then there could be a case for euro strength up to that 110 handle, maybe even more. Which, interestingly, if we go back to right here, I can make the case that a big driver of that sell-off, of that reversal, was actually euro strength. Yeah, because if you remember, you know, BOJ intervened here, it got bulls off that 152 level, but then it started to stall, holding above 145. What finally got us below 145 was a US CPI print on, I believe it was November the 10th of 22, right? But why did the dollar get smashed so hard off of that print? Again, it's right here, November 22. Well, because at the time, we were also seeing the ECB ramp up rate hikes. That's when the ECB had started to go to the table with 75 bip hikes. And then we get that November 10th piece of data, which was in this weekly bar, shows US CPI coming down. Well, that opened the door for the Fed to soften their rate hike approach. And as euro was ramping it up as an excuse for euro bulls, or at the very least for euro bears to close a position and euro bulls to take a shot off of some lows. And, you know, really that drove into the last trend that we had in euro dollar before it went range bound, which has been for the last 17 months now. But we draw back to dollar yen, and if there is that legitimate idea that USD strength is on its way out, Well, carry traders probably aren't going to wait around. And that's what helped to bring the reversal back here. It was a raft of dollar weakness on the back of lower CPI. It was also pushing the euro higher. It was pushing sterling higher. Similar type of scenario back here. It was US CPI. It was released on November 14th that brought a 1,000 plus pip pullback. That was a 23.6% pullback until support played in right off the same low December 28th. Well, if we know there's a perceived top in at 160, then that begins to impact the possible risk reward ratio that somebody could get off of this. Right? Like if we're at 158 and you fear that the BOJ is going to defend 160 again, that means there's an absolute top end of 200 pips, and that's if you get it out before they intervene. So the question then becomes, is that risk worthwhile? And we can see the pair starting to dip. Now, when I see something like that, I imagine that it's these long-term carriers that are watching this thing, looking at USD as support, looking at economic data and saying, you know what, I'm good here. I'll wait to see if I get a pullback. Otherwise, if this has any more top end, I'll just let it go. But that's what happens in crowded trades that get incredibly one-sided. You have folks that bought down here, that could still be holding on. And if they get the thought that the USD is about to go into reversal, which could happen off the basis of euro strength or sterling strength, then there could be a reason to abandon those carry trades, and that could lead to a very one-sided move very fast. You know, something else to consider here, though, is rollover or carry impacts both sides of the trade. Right? So longs can earn rollover. Shorts have to pay it. So what this means is if it's all factors considered, there's very little reason. Like you have this situation right here. Well, if you're short, you're paying roll. If you're long, you're earning it. So there's a bit more motivation for longs to set around in chop than there is for shorts to set around in chop when they have to pay for it. So this is something that becomes interesting, especially if we get another miss on NFP. And then if the Fed retains a dovish look in June, maybe even highlighting the possibility of a July rate cut, if that scenario plays through, then there could be a burgeoning case for dollar yen reversals. Say could be. Still got to watch the levels because that's been a massive bullish trend and it's not dead yet. So we're testing below 155 right now. You can even see on this 4-hour bar where it held the last 4-hour candle, but we're dipping below again. Now, if this 4-hour candle that closes an hour and 11 minutes, if this tapers back up and holds a low there, then that could open the door for short-term reversal or pullbacks off of this two-day move. Now, if it closes two consecutive days red, then I think that's where we can start seeing some shift. But, you know, chasing this, even if it's a fairly early or new reversal, that could be daunting as well. There's a couple spots to track in here. Like we had this swing low from Thursday, that swing low from Friday. Collectively between those two, that's what's held the high so far today. That, to me, becomes a decision point. It's pretty tight too, 156.38, 156.56, so 18 pips, give or take. But I could draw that up as a zone. And I'm gonna go down to like an hourly or a 4-hour. I know what I wanna watch. There we go. So if this is gonna show bullish reversal, then I need to see a hold of 155. 156.04 then becomes an issue to deal with on the way back up. And then it's this zone. We have support turned resistance. That's the decision point. I would need to see buyers drive back above that to give me the idea that bulls are getting back on the driver's seat on dollar yen. That's what I'm looking at there. All right, one last one, and then I got a couple questions that I wanted to get to. Gold. So I tweeted this over the weekend, but let's take a long-term, bigger picture look at gold. Move all my annotations. There we go. Okay, so that's the monthly chart of gold. Let me even get rid of the 200. That's the monthly chart on gold. Now notice what happened at each of these swings. Extended upper wicks, right? Now not every extended wick gets follow through, but most waves in this range did see an extended wick on one side or the other before it went into the other direction. So now I can just draw a horizontal line right off of that first one, which is like 2075. Now, March, we broke out of this one with aggression. And it's just continued to fly. But now you see those two extended upper wicks. Let's get rid of those drawings again. You see those two extended upper wicks. There's a couple of different ways to take this. One, even after the extended reversal or the extended upper wick in April, the reversal that we saw off of those highs, bears were not able to get any additional follow through. It's not for a lack of trying, but they went back up to the well, hit 2450 as a high, and then a similar type of scenario developed where we saw profit taking and maybe even some shorts trying to take a shot off of a fresh cycle level test. But once we go down a little shorter term, see like off the weekly, that same 23, 26-ish area. And off the daily. All right, you can see where bears had an open door to take control there, they were thwarted. Open door to take control here, so far they've been thwarted off that same 23, 25 level. So while I think it's a growing probability that we see a pullback in this on the basis of what we have on the monthly chart, I don't know that bulls are done yet. And what this instead says to me is that it might be the next cycle level up. 2,500, I think that's a big one if it does come into play. And if we get 2,500, I think we'd see enough profit taking where it could establish at a minimum a local top or a local high. Because you could already see where bulls are getting jumpy here, as shown by those extended upper wicks, right? The challenge is that buyers haven't been getting interested again until it gets cleaned out and we get down here towards support, right? Like we had one daily close below 2,300. Bulls responded in a big way. They haven't been back there since. This time they come in at 2,325, which is simply a prior swing low that had turned into resistance, back to support, and it's back into support again. Right, so you can't really see that bullish response until we get down into a value area, at which point they've been responding somewhat aggressively. Now to get this a little shorter term, I do have a number of levels that I think remain of interest here. And it's a lot of the same ones we looked at last week. So coming into May, we had resistance 2319 to 2326. That's been support of late. Support again this morning. Resistance. This has been getting tougher and tougher. That same 2350 to 2354 zone. Held resistance here in April. More recently, it's been back into the equation. 2354 caught the high yesterday, and the sellers went right back in. But you know, if I'm reading this off like a two-hour chart, this looks like a range to me. And with a slightly bearish bias, slightly bearish because I'm taking this high to that high to that high. But still range bound, and it doesn't look like bulls are done yet. But that doesn't mean that it can't happen in the next few weeks to a month. Those extended upper wicks on the monthly, in my opinion, are saying something. So if we get back above 24, I think the bulls might get jumpy again. Not necessarily to the point where it's going to cauterize a high at 24, but it does highlight that buying above that level could be daunting. And if I'm thinking that, others might think that. If others are thinking that, that could impact the flow. If it impacts the flow, could end up showing a price. But what I'd want to see there, hold the support. I need to see some rectification of that 2350, 2354 zone that's become somewhat of a stickler. Above that, I'm looking at 2372 to 2378. And that 2400 level, which has been, again, somewhat problematic. 2450 has the current ATH, but 2500 is that round psychological level setting above that I think could be a more proactive area to look for a top to develop. If we get above 2501, that's going to feel a lot more expensive than just $2 above 2499. But that, my friends, is what I have for today. Did get a couple questions in here that I wanted to point out. And I already talked about Aussie. I didn't go super in depth on it, but Carr wanted to look at Aussie and be happy to touch on it a bit deeper. So again, I think what's exciting on something like this is the Chinese proxy play. But you know, take it from tops down. You know, it's that 63 area that's been pretty sticky. I had Aussie very, very noisy in the early part of the year. I mean, again, this looks like one of those Rorschach diagrams, right? Back and forth with very little order or or semblance of formality. What we've had since late April, though, has been a bit cleaner. You know, that's where we had the pop of this low, run up to a higher high, pullback of which has held that 23.6 FIBO. So if I had to look for an upper projection, you know, maybe something off this trend line, although the trend line hasn't been perfect, but maybe something right there around 67.30. But if we see the dollar get throttled, if we see the dollar pull back, I think this is going to remain as one of the more attractive long US long setups against a short USD. Stoner Glitz asking, can we see pound yen? For sure. So I kind of took this off my radar after it stalled at the ATH, but it's a pretty clean pullback. So what I meant by that is, like, we had that 200 flat level. I'm just going back. This zone still is bringing some impact, and it's simply the gap here between August and September of 08. Right in there. It's like a 450 pip gap, though. And you can see where it started to come back into the picture here in March. Stalled ahead and then eventually broke out in a very big way. There we go. Now, the first test that filled that gap, that was the same morning that the BOJ intervened to defend 160 on dollar yen. And pound yen is defending above 200. 200 is a major psychological level there. And that's one of those prices that I'd be very, very bashful to try to get long above. Now, it didn't stop some folks. Some folks tried to run the break. They just continued to get grinded through here. This has been the first notable pullback in the pair since that plus 200 test. 197.38 is a swing that I've been tracking. And I simply just pulled that off the lower high that developed after the initial intervention. So the intervention hit right here. We went down right to the bottom part of that gap, that 16-year gap. And at the bottom of that 16-year gap, and we get a 400-plus pip rally off that thing. But that's where it stalled out, 197.38. Did show a bit of support here again, but it's back in the picture now. And, you know, I'd meant to kind of get back into this theme when I looked at dollar yen and then cable and euro, but you know, for short yen scenarios, there could be a better case away from USD right now. But get a little bit tighter. You see that support bounce coming in hourly. Initial support bounce from that is now caught at the top side of that zone. You can see where there's been a couple of points of resistance in there. Let's go even tighter. Bring in a chart. So now it looks like it's building an ascending triangle with that top side of the prior gap from 16 years ago helping to set resistance. So this would be something that I generally approach with a bullish aim. As far as resistance, you know, like I said, 200, I get a bit jumpy on one of those psych levels that's already shown some aggressive swings. But if you go down here, you know, you're going to find a couple of different swing lows that I think remain proactive for short-term resistance. I'm going to pull these off like a 4 hour though. So that was visible right in there, like 198.76. All right, that remains of interest. A little bit higher. Notice there was two almost perfect touches there to set that one. Might even be close enough for a double bottom. That double bottom may have already filled too. Let me just double check that. Yep, double bottom. So this double bottom, that neckline, that was completion right there, which is what's another item that's helping to set some support intraday. Short-term ascending triangle. That's what I'm looking at, pound yen. Jamie with a good question here. Does U.S. weakness imply more strength from China? No, not necessarily. You know, with globalization, a rising tide can lift all boats. But it's, I think, kind of a matter at that point, right? If we're in a healthy economic backdrop where global growth is a positive, then generally the higher beta is going to attract capital flows. Like as a case in point, what I was talking about with NQ and ES a little earlier, in my mind, if expectations are for higher stock prices, then there's a much more fervent argument on the long side of NQ than there is on ES, because NQ are these higher beta, generally speaking, riskier types of companies, tech heavy companies that in a growth phase will benefit more than an established stalwart blue chip type of company. So if we are in a scenario where there's strength behind global growth and we see China growing, US growing, then China could attract capital flows away from the US simply by the prospect of a higher possible rate of return or higher perceived return potential. That's globalization. But again, similar interplay that I saw was talking about with ES and NQ, just based on the constituency of the indexes. And then one last one from Jamie asked for silver. I don't do much on silver. I mainly stick to macro stuff, and silver gets a little bit outside of that for me. But with that said, we're back below the 30 big fig. So, something like this, I'll usually take a longer term type of approach with it. As in, I'm not like averse to taking on exposure in this market, but I want the setup to be exceptional if I'm going to go outside of my comfort zone, because I have to then manage it more actively, because it's not something that I'm used to. It's not something that I do every day. So I'll take it, but it's got to be exceptional. Here, the question would be whether or not it's loading up for another test above 30 and a drive above 30. And where I get really caught up with silver is the gold overlay, right? Because, if we're looking at it from a basis of monetary or fiat dilution, what we had in 2011 versus what we have today is very askew. Now, that works a bit more for me in gold, right? Because if we look at gold, 2011 highs all the way down here, like 1920s, we're well above that today. Makes sense to me. Silver, on the other hand, silver was flirting with a 50 handle back in 2011, and now we're talking about 30. I don't understand that. And that kind of makes it a problem for me. But that said, a chart's a chart. Price action is price action. So we had the breakout failed. You can see where some bulls were still trying to fire above 30, just couldn't get very far. There we go. Got the lower high. Now it's printing down to a lower low. That spot right there becomes of interest, 29.11. 29.11, quite simply, is a 50 fib of this long-term move, taking the low in October, November 08 and the high that printed in 2011. More interestingly than that, that 50 fib has done, it's caught a few different highs, a few different notable highs right in here. So collectively, I could color that zone between 29.11 up to 30 and call that a resistance turn support zone. But to see that, I need to see actual support play in, which hasn't happened yet. We just pierced through the top side of it. But if we end up with an extended underside wick over the next couple of days within that zone, that could be a different story altogether. That's something that could support the idea of bullish trend continuation after the 30 breakout. The key on these types of things is I want to have an area where I can manage my risk so that if I'm wrong, I could lose little, right? And I don't really feel that I have something like that when prices are still on the way down. I basically have to guess where the low is, as opposed to using something like this and say, okay, well, we've had a couple of bounces here. If I'm going to look for a bullish swing play, I know where the low should remain. And if it doesn't, then I want to get the heck out of there anyways, because I don't want to be sitting in a position that's eating equity. But that's my line in the sand. That's the area I'm comfortable with. We don't have that right now. But if we test 29.11 and then get a couple of underside wicks showing bulls responding, then that's when I can begin to get more comfortable with it. I'm just not there yet. But that's what I'm looking at on silver. A couple questions on oil. How do you see oil still bearish? Let me look. I did this one. I'm a little more active with oil than I'm silver, but that's pretty bearish, man. Yeah, it's pretty bearish. Breaking through that support zone. It's not something I'd want to chase lower. Right? You go out longer term and there's kind of like a long-term area of support down here on 67.5, and that would that would cap top end potential on bearish trend sets, which would not be very attractive to me. But and at this point, I feel like catching a falling knife. And then on the short side, I just don't know how much juice is in the squeeze. But, you know, if it could firm back up to 75, find some resistance, give me an area there to work off of, I mean, maybe there's something there on the short side. It's just not there right now. Another question from Jamie. How do oil futures complement the narrative? Well, I mean, oil is its own market. You know, you got OPEC Plus and Russia that, you know, essentially have a say in controlling the flow. For a long time, it was looked at as, you know, a kind of a precursor to global growth, as in if we were seeing higher oil prices, it was something that was in anticipation of you know, greater overall global growth, and weaker oil prices on the back of, you know, slowdown fears. I don't really buy into that very much. I mean, I think like many correlations, it'll have times where it fits, but other times where it doesn't, you know, but that's one of the dangers with correlations in general. Is it's a correlation and they break and they split at some point. And, you know, as a trader, you're going to be wrong a lot, but what you really have to try to eliminate is those areas where you're right, but still lose. Preferably you'd want to be able to be wrong and still win, which I know doesn't sound very intelligent, but it's, I think it's possible to do if hedging off risk appropriately. You try to put yourself in positions where you could still win, even if you were wrong. But, you know, with oil, with silver, with any of these markets, in my opinion, if you want to trade that market. You know, don't trade gold because silver's looking like it has support. Don't trade stocks because it looks like oil is gonna jump off of support. They're very different markets, and that's the market that's going to stop you out or give you a margin call. That's the market that matters to what you're doing. So I don't want to say bearish on correlations, but the reality is I probably am pretty bearish on correlations. More interesting to me isn't where they correlate, it's when they diverge, because when they diverge, that could be saying something else, right? There could be a message to deduce from that divergence, as opposed to just following it because it's supposed to be correlated. You know, I know a lot of people do that with oil and CAD, you know, or Aussie and gold. It's just not my thing. If I want to trade Aussie, I trade Aussie. If I want to trade gold, I trade gold. Sometimes they'll correlate, sometimes they won't. You know, the answer as to what's behind that correlation, that's usually what we're debating about in the news or in the headlines or whatever. And I think that's where it becomes really easy to get caught into noise, you know, overthinking things. At the end of the day, nothing is predictive. Technical analysis is not predictive. Fundamental analysis is not predictive. In my mind, nothing is predictive. The reason I look at these charts is the prospect of asymmetry. Areas where I could try to risk a dollar in order to try to make two. That's where support and resistance comes into play. And then trends come into play because of biases, right? If something's trending, there's probably a reason for it. That doesn't mean I want to throw all my, you know, throw all my risk out the window and just say, oh, the trend is up, I'm going to buy and just hope that it continues. Well, no, that's when, again, you can incorporate some analysis, look for a pullback, try to find support, area where I could risk a dollar to try to make two, and let that trend that's taking over continue to take over. And if it switches or changes or flips, okay, well, that's what I got to stop there for. But I'm of the mind that nothing is predictive. And the whole reason that I look at charts is exactly because I don't feel the fundamentals are predictive any more than technicals. You know, but at the very least, technicals give me an area to implement strategy. Gives me a way where I can use analysis in a proactive manner so that if I do see four consecutive days of support building at a level that's clearly lined as a Fibonacci level, well, then I can look for a bounce to continue. And then once that level's taken out, all right, well, something else is shifting. Then I see that support coming in. All right, well, I got a level to work off of. It gets back above, then I look for the range to continue. When it gets to resistance, I look for it to go the other way. It's not gonna be perfect, but on the same token, you know, I think playing the prediction game is kind of like chasing your tail. You know, sometimes you might catch it, but then what are you going to do with it? But that, my friends, is what I have for today. I want to say thank you so much, everybody, for your time. I really do appreciate it. I'll be back next week, Tuesday, same time, same place. If you have the time to visit with me, we'd love to see you back in the room. But thank you for that time. Hope you have a fantastic rest of the day. And as always, happy trading, ladies and gentlemen.